Well, good morning, everyone. We've reconvened in public session for the continuation of the 13th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. May I welcome today Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work, and Michael Russell, Minister for UK Negotiations and Scotland's Place in Europe. The ministers have with them a number of Scottish Government officials to assist with the questions to be put to the ministers, and these are Gary Gillespie, the Chief Economist, Simon Fuller, who is the OCEA Economic Analysis Division, and George Burgess, Deputy Director for EU and International Trade and Investment Policy. If I could ask the Cabinet Secretary to begin with a short statement which he's prepared, and then we will move into questions from committee members.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity as well to contribute to the investigation that the committee is having on the potential economic impacts of the result of the EU referendum. I certainly welcome the scope of the committee's considerations and look forward to receiving the committee's recommendations on these areas, and as I say, welcome the opportunity to appear today. When I did appear before this committee on the 28th of June, which of course was less than a week after the result of the EU referendum, I highlighted then several things. First of all, that the result had changed the economic climate in Scotland, the UK, and indeed the whole of Europe. That it would inevitably lead to a period of economic uncertainty, and that it would add to the already significant external headwinds facing the Scottish economy. But I was also clear that the Scottish economy was facing these headwinds from a position of relative resilience and strength. And I think the experience over the past few months has underlined those points. So first of all, Scotland's economy grew by 0.4% in the 3 months leading up to the referendum, which had been the highest rate of quarterly growth since the start of 2015. Scotland's labour market has continued to perform strongly. Latest data shows that the employment level in Scotland is now 40,000 above its pre-recession peak and 166,000 above the recession trough. The unemployment rate in Scotland has fallen to 4.7%, lower than the UK's rate of 4.8%. So despite continuing economic concerns following the EU referendum result, it's encouraging that the underlying resilience of the Scottish economy remains strong. However, if we start to look ahead to the next 18 months, the outlook for Scotland in terms of growth and indeed for the UK has weakened following the referendum. Economic forecasters have significantly downgraded their growth projections for 2017 to reflect the heightened uncertainty and increasing inflationary pressures following Brexit. All of this will start to dampen employment prospects, business profitability, household incomes and earnings. And longer term, we also know that the independent economic forecasts point to a range of possible impacts for the economy from a redefined relationship with the EU. There is widespread agreement that a UK-EU trade relationship reliant on WTO rules, or what's often called a hard Brexit, represents the worst possible outcome for trade and for the economy. So the path ahead is uncertain, but we are very clear that Scotland's relationship with the EU and its place in the single market must be protected. We have, as you know, Convener, a small open economy in a rapidly changing and globalised world, and our ability to create a more productive and fairer Scotland depends more than ever on trading with the rest of the world and attracting investment into our economy, into our businesses and assets. Being part of the EU makes easier the free movement of goods, services, workers and capital. It opens up opportunities for citizens, workers, businesses and consumers. Any relationship with the EU short of full membership of the single market risks increasing barriers to trade, as well as reducing exports and lowering migration, all of which will affect the rates of growth, but also reduce productivity. The Fraser-Vallander Institute has estimated that leaving the single market under a World Trade Organization scenario could result in our economy being worse off by about 5% overall, about £8 billion. After a decade, and that's compared with the position if we were to remain in the EU. That is 80,000 fewer jobs and real wages lower by £200 a head a year. And there is a fairly rare consensus from economists, who often don't show a consensus, and various think tanks on the issue of Brexit. Analysis has shown that it will be bad for exports, for investment and for jobs, and that means that it's bad for productivity, for economic growth and tax receipts. That view is also shared by the OBR and indeed the Treasury. It was set out quite clearly by the Chancellor during his autumn statement. Brexit has lowered the outlook for economic growth, and has in turn led to forecasts of increased borrowing to the tune of more than £100 billion over the forecast period. Ultimately, for households already dealing with the impacts of austerity, Brexit has led to a rise in inflationary pressures, which, combined with a benefits freeze and a weaker outlook for earnings, will squeeze incomes further. I think, crucially, analysis by the IFS, Institute for Fiscal Studies, shows that by 2021, wages will still be lower than they were in 2008. Now, that implies 13 years without any growth in real wages, the longest period of stagnant wages since World War II. There's therefore a pressing need for us to try and minimise this potential damage. That's why we have been unequivocal on the importance of membership of the single market and on our determination to retain that membership. That's not to say that we prioritise our trade with the EU at the expense of our trade with the UK. We're clear that we want to maintain our relationship with both vital partners. The two are not incompatible. We've heard, for example, from David Davis that there won't be a hard border between Northern Ireland and the Republic, and I'm confident the same would be the case between Scotland and the rest of the UK, should Scotland be able to secure our relationship with the EU. We are currently in the process of opening a trade and investment hub in London to attract further investment north of the border, building on recent post-EU referendum investments from companies such as Chevron Aircraft Maintenance and also GlaxoSmithKline. And these investments, I believe, are a vote of confidence in the economy, and the Scottish Government is clear that we remain open to investment from the rest of the UK, from Europe and from further afield. But as I alluded to earlier, it's not just the vote to leave the EU that's proving an unnecessary headwind to the Scottish economy. We are also hamstrung by much of the economic policy led from Westminster. On oil and gas, the Chancellor has chosen not to implement the strong package of support which is needed for the North Sea and which has so gravely affected those communities which continue to be impacted by low oil prices. And generally, our economic progress is hindered further by continued austerity and a protracted period of underinvestment in economic infrastructure. So even with the increased investment announced last week, which was welcome, Scotland's capital budget will still have been 8% lower across this decade. And what was announced last week was simply a moderation of existing cuts. In contrast, we have prioritised capital investment despite cuts to capital budgets. So major transport projects like the Queen's Ferry Crossing, the M8, M73, M74 motorway improvements projects, the continuation of the Edinburgh-Glasgow Rail Improvement Programme. And we'll also invest £3 billion to build 50,000 affordable homes over this Parliament. During 2016-17, we'll invest £90 million in Scotland's digital infrastructure to help towards our 2017 target to ensure 95% of premises in Scotland have access to next-generation broadband. And all of that investment is aimed at stimulating our economy, but also improving our asset base in order to boost long-term productivity. And we've made progress in improving productivity performance, narrowing the productivity gap with the UK since 2007. But we know that further improvement is required. Our ambition is for Scotland to rank among the top-performing OECD nations. So in conclusion, Convener, the vote to leave the EU is an unwelcome barrier in the roads towards fulfilling that ambition. And that's why the Government's goal of keeping Scotland, and indeed the whole of the UK, is to remain inside the single market. I'd welcome the opportunity to listen to and to work closely with MSPs. I've made that offer before from across the Parliament who share that goal. And in the coming weeks, we'll be able to table specific proposals to protect Scotland's interests and to keep us in the single market, even if the rest of the UK decides to leave. We believe that this outcome is in the best interests of everyone in these islands. And I look forward to the committee's recommendations and happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned exports in your statement. Now, I'm just wondering, is there anything over and above what has already been publicly announced that the Scottish Government is doing to promote Scottish exports across Europe and beyond?
Well, much of what's been announced you'll be aware of, but in addition to that, work goes on all the time. So there's a programme of visits from ministers, for example. I recently attended the ADIPEC conference in Abu Dhabi, which is a huge opportunity for Scottish companies to export. I think what was interesting about that is there were a large number of companies, as you would expect, that were from the northeast. Some of whom told me that they had previously been exclusively focused on the North Sea oil market. That's the market they had known. but we're now reaching out to try and access different markets around the Middle East. So there is that recognition that we have to support that. We had a number of events in Abu Dhabi, helped a lot of the companies which were otherwise quite small to establish that presence. The restrictions there will be, of course, the cost of setting up an office, and for many people, the 180 days that they're allowed to actually be there in terms of the visa. So a lot of work has gone on in that regard. In addition to that, as I say, ministers, when they're going on other on trips for other reasons, also promote Scotland. So the First Minister today, as you'll know, is in Dublin, and part of what she will be doing is to announce the filling of the extra position to boost the SDI presence in Dublin for the new office that we have there. You'll be aware of other ambitions we have in terms of London and Berlin as well. And just to say, although we have announced the establishment of a trade board, I think it's worth pointing out today as part of that four-point plan announced by the First Minister last month that we have begun the process for appointing members of that board, which I will chair, and that board will harness the expertise and experience of members from a wide range of business perspectives that will enable us to focus our efforts more effectively. A great deal of activity going on throughout the UK as well as throughout the EU and indeed in other countries to try and boost trade.
A question from Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Convener. And can I just apologise in advance that, to the committee and to witnesses that I will have to leave the committee early due to a family commitment. I was wanting to ask a question. We've heard over the last number of weeks about the lack of data relating to exports and actually being able to identify what constitutes an export from Scotland. And I'm just wondering, some of the evidence we heard suggested that 50% of our exports are being generated by only 50 companies. And I'm just wondering if that was the Scottish Government's understanding, and is there any reason that you've been able to identify why our exporting base is so low?
I think there's actually just been put on to the internet a pretty good guide as to how these are defined and the different sources for those definitions. So we tend to do it on the basis of a survey of companies which are exporting. But there has been, I think, questions around, you know, the nature of exports for the rest of the UK, the extent to which they are then exported elsewhere, and whether they are properly accounted for in the export figures that we have. But they have, as you've said, we have the basic facts of 50% of Scotland's international exports being attributed to actually a very small number of businesses, and 60% of Scotland's international exports also. So right up to 60%, you're talking about potentially 130 businesses. So I think one of the reasons for the economic and skills review is because we realise we haven't done what we need to do in terms of exports or indeed internationalisation. So there's more being done and seeing more companies. I've just mentioned some of those from the Northeast in particular that for the first time are starting to look at export markets in a very serious way. But that review will specifically give us the focus and try and draw together within the government the different resources that we have. So ministers going abroad and undertaking these engagements or throughout the rest of the UK. The Chamber of Commerce has a very active network which we want to tap into. We obviously have our university sector, which is very active, including bases abroad in Dubai and Singapore and places like that. I think what we are trying to do is trying to bring those things together so that we can more effectively internationalise our companies. And one of the points here relates to productivity. If you're exporting into a more competitive, productive market, that tends to be a discipline which then is felt back in your own organisation. So internationalisation has that benefit as well. So I think the enterprise and skills reviews are recognition that we haven't done as much, and it's been true of previous administrations and their ambitions as well in terms of expanding the export base of the Scottish economy. We're very seized of that. As to the technical side of it, I would recommend what's been put on the Scottish Government website today in terms of exports, but I don't know whether Convener, the Chief Economist, wants to mention something in relation to that.
Okay, thanks very much. I think just to reinforce the point made by the Cabinet Secretary that, okay, there's a small number of companies account for a lot of international exports. That's probably not uncommon in a lot of small economies. The nature of international trade tends to be concentrated in larger international companies, and they do that for a number of reasons. One is to capture the benefits internally, the internal knowledge that they generate, and that's something we see in a lot of other places. I think the challenge, as the Cabinet Secretary has outlined, is getting a broader base of the SME base, internationally active, so that when they grow in international markets as well. On the international trade statistics, as the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned, we've put a note on the website which answers some of the questions, I think, that have arisen during the inquiry around re-exporting, the extent to which our exports capture the final destination of trade, and what we don't know in the context of imports from our UK and other trade flows. So I'm happy to say a little bit more about that in due course, but essentially that information is now available.
Thank you. And Gil Paterson.
A quick follow-up on that. We had a number of witnesses before us, for instance, the Scottish Quiz Association. David Williams said, obtaining detailed and accurate Scottish export statistics has been a challenge. Scottish Engineering, Brian Buchanan, he talks about flotation devices that manufacture in Aberdeen and are not counted as Scottish exports. And then, if I just directly quote this, this comes from Scotland's Food and Drink Limited. That's James Withers. He says, I'm almost certain that the 1.1 billion of food exports undervalues what we export for precisely the reason that Gil Paterson gave in talking about port of departure. So I know that the Scottish Government, I know that the Office of National Statistics, it's a reserved matter, but I'm wondering if the Scottish Government are putting some resources to delve into these, because it's quite fundamental to what, you know, understanding of exactly where our exports go to and what the value of them is. And we're kind of talking in a value in a vacuum, because it looks as if the stats are just not accurate.
Yeah, I think it's a very good point, and it's been made during the course of the Enterprise and Skills Review again, actually across the piece, not just in relation to exports. The quality and extent of the information that we had is not what we'd want it to be. So part of that review, and we're now in phase two of that review, is to examine really what are the nature of the stats, the information that we need, the data that will allow us to get a proper assessment of that. You're right to say, not in all cases, but in many cases, we're reliant upon the ONS and other figures. And that's not sufficient. And I think if we are to make those changes in terms of internationalisation, exporting, productivity, then we have to have the figures that enable us, and they've got to be more accurate. So, for example, the labour market stats that we have are 3 months out of date and based on a survey of around, I think I'm right in saying, about 400 people in Scotland. Now, if you compare that with the output from the US economy, where you get very up-to-date and very definitive figures, I think there's more that we can do in relation to that. So in order to do that, we have tasked the Enterprise and Skills Review, the Ministerial Review Group, to look at that specifically. The other point I would say on exporting in particular, and I would recommend, it's only just gone up, so members wouldn't have had the opportunity to see it, but I would recommend that Q&A, which is now on the Scottish Government's website, there is perhaps sometimes more clarity than we would realise in terms of some of the figures, but you're right to say other parts of it are partly disguised. It's not possible to be as definitive as we'd like as to where, say, exports to the rest of the UK then go on to. And there's also what's called the Rotterdam effect, which I'm not trying to explain just now, convener, but it can be seen in that a question and answer session. So yes, I concede we need to have better data on which to base not just the decisions that we take, but our judgment as to how the economy is performing.
Will this be peculiar research in Scotland, is it based on the ONS research?
Sorry, the Enterprise and Skills Review, yes. Investigation. Now that will be based on, it's in Scotland, so that review group, which involves people from industry and from the organisations involved in providing enterprise and skills, plus many other, I hesitate to say the word experts, but I think that's what they are, looking at the issue of the range of economic data that we have. So it will be specifically for the Scottish economy. And I don't think we should be afraid if at the end of that, the suggestion is that we should be commissioning extra information, which is very specific and tailored to the Scottish economy, that we shouldn't proceed with that. I think it is necessary for us to, for example, there's one measure, I think, called the whole of the economy report, which we don't have in Scotland, which other economies do. So I think we should really have that root and branch review of the information that we've got, and it should be designed in order, of course, to advise the public and inform the public and obviously parliamentarians as well. But it should be devised in order to make it as easy as possible for us to judge how the economy is doing and to base decisions on as to how we can improve the economy. But it will be undertaken by that ministerial review group here in Scotland. It may, of course, if this is the point of your question, may result in an ask of ONS to say, this doesn't suit us, is it possible to do it in this way? Because there's obviously a real value in having objective analysis of these figures. But again, I wouldn't want to prejudge what the outcome of that review would be at this stage.
Okay.
Can I add to the Cabinet Secretary's comments? So in a sense, we rely on the ONS to produce a lot of data, economic data, on a UK basis with a disaggregated data set for Scotland. We typically pay for a boost to that sample to allow greater analysis, and that's the example in the labour market and other areas. But I suppose the data of interest here is the kind of Global Connection Survey. And that's a Scottish-based survey. It's run by Scottish Government statisticians. It goes out to around 5,500 businesses, which targets the large exporters. But what crucially it tries to do and captures, it captures goods and services being traded from Scotland with the rest of the UK. And it's very difficult to get intra-UK trade. Even at the UK level, they have one source, which is the input output tables, and that whole trade flow data is really, really difficult. So that's something that we run. The next publications in January for 2015, and that's the main source of Scottish export destinations, and we supplement that both with HMRC data, monthly returns we get from ONS, and it's done on a collaborative basis. But as the Cabinet Secretary has alluded to, there's obviously gaps in the data, and further work is ongoing.
Right, thank you. Jackie Bailey.
Can I start by welcoming the Cabinet Secretary's very clear comments about the importance of the UK market to Scotland? He'll forgive me for saying that it stands in contrast to comments made by his colleague Stuart Hosey earlier in the week, so your clarity is absolutely welcome. I know he shares my understanding that proximity to markets is a key driver in increasing exporting. So on that basis, can I focus on SDI and their field ops, because he answered a series of parliamentary questions to me, and I want to tease some of them out. We have 29 offices, as I understand it, across the globe. Only one in our biggest market, which is the rest of the UK. And I wonder whether you could explain the strategy that sees one in a market that's £48.5 billion compared to 28 in a market that delivers us £26 billion.
Yeah, I think it would be, I think, apparent and obvious to anybody giving that a bit of thought that the rest of the UK is unlike our other markets in as far as we have huge numbers of connections with the rest of the UK at all sorts of levels and all sorts of different sectors. So I don't think that the same imperatives apply. We have those connections, we have obviously, we have representatives in UK Parliament, we've got representatives on UK trade bodies, we have a whole host of connections. So I think the development of the London office and the further development of the London office has been important to help boost that, especially at a time of uncertainty in relation to the EU referendum vote. But I think, just as I've said, how valuable the UK market is to us, and we've had some recent successes in relation to that, I think you can also fairly obviously see the number of other connections that we have across all sorts of different sectors, which is unlike the sectors, the relationships we'd have with, say, China or India or indeed other parts of the EU.
Okay, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? I do note that the London hub is being created, so clearly he's not dismissing the importance of the UK market. I wonder, though, how many people will be in the London hub? And the reason I ask that is you're moving staff from London to Dublin, which is pertinent to the First Minister's announcement today. My understanding is 8 and 3 are being moved across to Dublin. So how many are left in London?
There'll be, sorry, just to clarify that in Dublin, as you said, there's going to be the establishment of that unit, which means there's extra staff. There'll be a doubling of the numbers across the EU. And as I understand it, and perhaps Mr. Burgess could confirm, there'll be extra staff also in London, which is designed to... the extra staff will be in Dublin. So Dublin and London together, there is a relationship there. You may be aware of, since the Brexit vote, there was at least a lot of discussion. It's hard to know how much more than that there was about possible fallout from the Brexit vote of companies potentially moving to Dublin. And because it was deemed to be remaining within the EU and English-speaking, which is very attractive to companies. And also, it's true to say that the Republic of Ireland has been extremely successful in attracting businesses to come to it over recent years. And again, it's a vital part of the FM's itinerary today. She's meeting with 100 business leaders. So for the exact numbers for SDI, perhaps Mr. Burgess or Gary Gillespie could talk about that. Again, I think the member is right to say that we have recognised the importance. I think the vast majority, well, I know the vast majority of inward investment into the UK comes through London, and very often that will bounce on to Scotland, and we want to encourage that. So conferences like the what's called the MIPIM conferences are things that we're showing a presence, along with the seven cities in Scotland showing a presence. I've gone to visit that myself in recent years. So we've recognised that by the creation of the London office. And do you want to say anything about the numbers, George?
Yes, just very briefly. In the Dublin hub, which has been established for some time, we already have two members of Scottish Government staff. They are going to be joined by a member of SDI staff. That's an early part of the doubling of SDI's presence in European markets. And I think we are quite clear, SDI are quite clear, that is additional resource. That's not simply moving people from one office to another. I mean, SDI will be looking at precisely which people are best in which places, but this is not a diminution of the London presence to create the extra presence in the other markets.
I wonder, therefore, whether you could explain to me the answer to the parliamentary question I asked that indicated, and it's S5W03970, that indicated that when the London hub opens in 2017, the 8 people working for SDI and the 3 people working for Scottish Enterprise in London will move to Dublin. I'm not quite sure that fits in with the answer you just gave me. I'm happy to share the PQ. It's a matter of public record. It's in the name of the Cabinet Secretary.
I think it does. I think what we're seeing is additional staff will move to Dublin. But at any given time, the last visit I had to the SDI and Scottish Enterprises post-Brexit in London, I think there was 8-9 people there. What we're saying is we intend to further boost that. And I think it's also true to say that if you visited the office yourself, but you'll know that it's often the case that the desks which are used there are used by other aspects of Scottish Government as well. So the intention is to boost that presence that we have in London. It's been successful so far, but we believe it can be more successful. Do you want to say any more?
I think it's important in terms of the relative priority the Scottish Government attached to things. Yeah. For us to understand, are you taking staff away from London to Dublin? Are you replacing them? What will be the complement in London?
I think Mr. Burgess wanted to come in perhaps to address that.
Sorry, I think I can clarify. I suspect that this may be a good old-fashioned typo. The intention is that the staff from SDI and Scottish Enterprise already in London will move into the London hub. I certainly have no knowledge that they are being translated to Dublin, pleasant though that may be.
My final question.
Allow me to investigate that and we can come back and clarify.
I think that would be helpful, and if you wanted to review any other typos that might exist, I'm sure that the colleague MSPs would be very pleased to see that happen. One final point, because I think, again, this is important. In relation to SDI's budget, it's been declining year on year, so I'm keen to know whether the additional staff talked about in Europe from 20 to 40 will all entirely be new and additional staff, in which case SDI will get additional budget for it, or are they expected to cope within their existing financial envelope?
No, it wouldn't be possible, given the activities of SDI, for them to take on that additional number of staff within the same budget. I can't tell you what the budget for SDI will be now 2 weeks and a bit in advance of the budget itself, but no, it's not expected that SDI will manage to get by in the budget they currently have if they double the number of representatives they have in the EU, so it will be an increase.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think Dean Lockhart had a follow-up just on this point before we move on to another subject.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to our guests for coming along this morning. It's an important relationship between exports and productivity, as the Cabinet Secretary said. And in last week's autumn statement made by the Chancellor, he made it clear he wants the UK economy to be match fit. And he announced a number of measures to increase productivity across the UK, as a result of which an extra £800 million of capital spend is coming to Scotland. As I understand it, the Scottish Government's targets for Scotland to reach the first quartile of productivity for 2017 has not been met, and Scottish Enterprise have estimated that that has cost the UK, the Scottish economy, roughly £45 billion in additional GDP. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, the Scottish Government has control over a number of levers of policy for productivity, enterprise policy, education, skills, training and export networks. Can I ask two questions? How does the Scottish Government measure productivity? And secondly, when will new targets be introduced for productivity beyond 2017?
Can I say that I think implicit within that question is perhaps the first time a recognition from the member that there are two governments involved in the economy in Scotland. I think one of the members, former colleagues, Gavin Brown, made a statement to the effect that the vast majority of the substantial levers in the economy rested with the UK government. And I think it is important when we discuss whether it's productivity, export performance or other aspects of the economy, we do at least acknowledge that there are two governments involved in terms of the economy. On the second question that he asked, I think I've answered that previously in the chamber to say that, of course, as a result and part of the work of the Enterprise and Skills Review, we intend, as we've said, to have harder alignment across the different agencies which are involved there, and the other A word would be accountability in relation to that. So we expect to come out of that review with refreshed targets. We still have that overriding ambition to be in the top quartile in terms of the international performance, but refreshed targets and perhaps even more performance measures in relation to how we achieve those targets. As to the calculations for productivity, perhaps the Chief Economist could answer that question.
Mr. Gillespie.
Okay, thank you very much. So in terms of the target, firstly, there's been a target since 2007 to be in the top quarter of the OECD in terms of productivity. That's measured using output per hour worked usually, and it's calculated on an international basis. Scotland just sits behind the UK on that measure in the third quartile, the top of the third quartile, and around, I think, 19 percentage points behind Germany, which is the bottom of the first quartile. So that's in a sense the scale of the ambition. As you mentioned, there's a number of drivers of productivity, most of which are long-term drivers around education, skills, investment, innovation, and the types of things that improve the underlying competitiveness of your economy. So in a sense, it's very rare for economies to close the productivity gap very quickly. It tends to take an effort of time over a longer time period. And in a sense, that's the sense of the ambition the government have set out in the economic strategy. Alongside that, there's a dual mandate to reduce inequality. And the recent evidence, certainly from the OECD, World Bank, IMF, is actually that both are interlinked. And actually that without addressing some of the social and economic challenges facing parts of your economy, you won't reach the same levels of productivity as many of the first quartile countries.
Secretary wanted to come back in on that as well.
Just to add to the point that Mr. Lockhart made about the Chancellor's statement and investment in infrastructure, we think that's a vital part of improving productivity. So some of the large-scale projects that we have just now, the Queensferry Crossing, the M8 bundle, where to many people's surprise, for the first time we'll have motorway between Edinburgh and Glasgow, if you like, Main Street Scotland, and not yet a motorway. It will be after that project's complete. Each of these has an assessment, which I'm happy to provide the member with, for the extent to which they should boost the productive potential of the economy. And we've been doing that for many years. I should say, though, in relation to the £800 million that the member mentioned, that represents a reduction in the cut rather than an improvement in Scotland's position over the 10 years from 2010 to 2020. So that should be the context in which that's taken. And I think the productivity fund, although that I think represents a number of different aspects from the Chancellor, is a recognition that some of the things that we've been doing in terms of infrastructure over previous years, the UK government is now seeking to do that as well, which is welcome. I just wish we could do more. We certainly have no shortage of projects that we could invest in were we able to do more in terms of the capital available to us.
And Mr. Gillespie, just to confirm, you did say that the Scottish Government, with new powers coming to Holyrood, has control over enterprise policy, education, skills, training and the export network, most of which are the drivers of productivity. So while I agree with the Cabinet Secretary, there are two governments involved to some extent in the economy. When it comes to productivity, most of the levers now lie with the Scottish Government. Would you agree with that?
Yes, in the context of the levers that you've outlined, they're essentially all levers that impact on the underlying competitiveness of the economy.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think Richard Leonard has a question, I think, for the Minister this time.
Yes. Resolution 601 committed the Scottish Government to promoting or protecting Scotland's place in the single market. And also contained an undertaking to report back regularly to parliamentarians and to report to Parliament on progress. So I wonder if the Minister for UK negotiations on Scotland's place in Europe could take this opportunity to share with us where lies Scotland's place in the single market as he sees it.
I'm pleased to do so. There have been regular reports, both to committees, to the Chamber, regular debates. And this is a live and also fast-moving situation. So, convening with your permission, very briefly, I'll say where I think we are at present. The Scottish Government will publish over the next few weeks a paper which will outline essentially what are the options that exist at this particular moment in time. But I think it's been clear from the debate that's taken place that they lie broadly in three areas. They lie in an undifferentiated option of leaving the European Union in exactly the same way as the United Kingdom intends to leave. Now, that is not entirely clear. I suspect the clearest definition we have of it is from the scribbled notes on the front of newspapers today, which I have to say accord pretty closely with the information that I've been able to glean. We don't get told things as clearly, but the information I've been able to glean over the last few months pretty much accords with those notes. And this is a difficult time in which the options in the UK are narrowing, but they don't seem prepared to say so. But I think it's fairly clear that we're heading for what might be called a hard Brexit in that undifferentiated option. Clearly, the other end of that spectrum is the possibility that we will not be able to find any other adequate solution but to move forward with an independence referendum and to give the people of Scotland the choice. In the middle, there are a range of differentiated options. And the success of those will depend upon the willingness of the United Kingdom government to include those in their negotiating position. Because it is quite clear that the United Kingdom government that will negotiate with the other 27 nations. So a lot of our work at present is fleshing out, examining, investigating, building evidence on those differentiated solutions. Now, I'm not going to go into great detail of those at the moment because that's the work that is ongoing for the paper. But the First Minister has indicated areas in which clearly there are possibilities. There are actually, I think, almost 30 sub-state arrangements that the European Union has with a variety of sub-states throughout Europe and elsewhere. And clearly some of those include, for example, EEA membership, although there's some dispute now as to whether the UK will exit EEA membership automatically or not. EEA membership, EFTA membership, membership of the customs union, but not within access to the single market. None of those are as good as remaining within the EU. And that's a very important piece of information. And we should look at this in a hierarchy. The first part of that hierarchy says we should stay where we are because that's the best possible arrangement we could have. The second part of that hierarchy says quite clearly what the UK should do is to remain within the European Economic Area and thus have full access to the single market, although not with the decision-making powers which it presently has. And the third part of that hierarchy says if we cannot do that, then Scotland should find a way to remain within that sort of structure in order to move forward. So the priority is to remain within the single market for economic reasons, but also for many other reasons. You know, free movement of labour is not simply an economic driver, though it is an economic driver in many key parts of the Scottish economy. Free movement of labour also expresses something about how we see ourselves and how we see our relationships with others and how we want our society to look and to feel. So we are working on those differentiated options. If you will have the bear with us and have the patience to wait a few more weeks, they will be even clearer, and we will lay them out in much more detail. And then, of course, you know, the Scottish Parliament will have to look at those very closely, as indeed the people of Scotland will have to look at those very closely and decide what they can have.
Are you saying that a Scotland short of independence could still potentially be a member of the European Free Trade Area and, by dint of that, a member of the European Economic Area?
I am saying that there are a range of options which we need to consider, and some of those will be hard to achieve and some of them will not be hard to achieve, but it is important to look at them all. I'm ruling absolutely nothing out. I noticed the First Minister made that point this morning in something that Guy Verhofstadt had said with regard to citizenship, where he had backed this proposal within parts of Europe that those people who are no longer EU citizens could pay to remain EU citizens. Now, she said quite clearly, some people will have said to Guy Verhofstadt, that is ridiculous, it can't be done, but others will have said, well, actually, that's an interesting idea, we look at it. We are in completely uncharted waters, and I don't think there's anything we should say is impossible to do. There may be some things which have not been done before and need debated and discussed. The key to this, however, will lie, and it is an important point, the key to this will lie in the willingness of the United Kingdom to fold into their negotiating position, whatever that turns out to be, you know, deals and opportunities which exist for other parts of the UK, and the Cabinet Secretary referred to Northern Ireland. It is absolutely clear that there must be a commitment, and indeed I was at the British Irish Council on Friday in Cardiff. Well, this was made very clear by the Northern Irish as well as by the Taoiseach, that there has to be a deal for Ireland as an island that does not have a hard border and create circumstances. Just as there will have to be, I suspect many people realise this, there will have to be a deal for Gibraltar. So there is still and must be the possibility for special deals for Scotland, except I wouldn't use the term special deal. I might even convene a withdrawal, because what we are asking for is what we have. And that's an important way of looking at this. We're asking for the things that we already have and enjoy. That's not a special deal. That is, I think, a right that we should have.
Talking about possibilities, is there a willingness, at least of spirit, on the part of the UK government to allow for those options you're discussing?
Mr. Leonard, I would never speak for the UK government. I am certainly not qualified to do so. But I would say that I'm also an optimist. I would hope that there is that willingness. I have to say that I've had, you know, constructive discussions with David Davis, it seems like many of them now. We've met on several occasions. We'll continue through the JMCEN mechanism to meet. I think we're due to meet again within a few days, a few weeks, actually, to do that. I hope so. And I hope that would take the Prime Minister at her word when she said that she wanted Scotland to be fully engaged and fully involved. And she also said she wouldn't trigger Article 50 until there was a position agreed by the devolved administration. So I'm accepting the word of the UK government. I'm sure we should all try and do that.
Okay, thank you.
Liam Kerr.
Just a quick question to follow up from Richard Leonard's there. During our evidence sessions, we've heard from some sectors that most of their members seem to have voted leave, and or that they can see positives from what the Cabinet Secretary termed a hard Brexit. They've expressed their concern that their voice, or their sector's voice, is not being heard, and that opportunities will be missed. So what reassurances are you able to give to reassure them that their industry needs are not going to be forgotten and that their vote will be as important as perhaps the one that you're listening to?
Might I ask so that I'm clearer what I'm commenting on?
So in particular, I have in mind the fishing industry.
Oh, okay. That's one. Which other ones?
It's not really for me to answer the questions. We've taken a lot of evidence.
It is quite interesting. Well, let me address fishing, as that's the only one you've been able to mention. Mm-hmm. I have met with the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, along with Fergus Ewing. I've made it absolutely clear to them that their view is respected. I have actually asked them, as has Fergus Ewing, to come forward with their views about how they would structure a fisheries management in Scotland after the Common Fisheries Policy, and they're engaged in that task. And indeed, yesterday I met with another group of fishermen in my own constituency to have that. So I'm not only showing respect for their view, I'm asking them how they would see this working. And I think that is the right thing to do. If any sector, and I've spoken to many sectors. If any sector says we think there are advantages in this situation, then I'm very willing to listen to them, to understand them. I think the real question is the balance of advantage. You know, for example, the Scotch Whisky Association has indicated that they can see the way in which they might operate without a customs union. And that's because rules of origin are not particularly important to the Scottish Whisky Association. There isn't much in a bottle of whisky that has been manufactured outside Scotland or outside the EU. So I can understand that perspective. It doesn't actually make their life easier one way or the other, whether there's a customs union or not. But there are other sectors for whom the lack of a customs union would be immensely problematic. So we have to balance it between sectors, and we also have to balance it within sectors. Because if you look at fishing, a good example, there are most of the catching part of the fishery industry believes that the Common Fisheries Policy has not worked well for them. There's many reasons for that. You know, some blame other fishermen, some blame politicians. It's clearly there are difficulties with it. But there are other people within that sector, in the processing sector, for example, who are very nervous about what may lie ahead and who believe that the difficulties in markets will be problematic for them. So I'm trying to listen constructively to every sector, and I'm debating and discussing with every sector, and I'm open to that, and I'm folding that into my thinking as I take forward the negotiating task.
Might I ask, Minister, on that point of just going back to what we have discussed, I think you said in 2 weeks' time there will be a paper referring to the various options.
Not in 2 weeks' time. At some stage soon.
At some stage soon, so I'm not trying to tie you down to a timescale. I had thought you'd said 2 weeks' time. Have you made specific requests to the UK government regarding aspects of the negotiations? And if these have been in writing, do you have these that you could share with the committee? Or is it the case that you can't at this stage? I'm just wondering.
There are three things that govern this situation, Camino, which I think might be helpful. The first of which is that the JMC operates under the terms of the Memorandum of Understanding, which underpins the JMC structure. And that it requires confidentiality in the process, although to the greatest degree we have tried to make sure that information is always made available from JMCs in the spirit of the Parliament, which is a Parliament based upon openness and transparency. So we juggle that, but the MOU does require, and rightly I think requires in certain circumstances, confidentiality. Second one is we are in the process of negotiation, and while I am very keen to be as open as I can, and this meeting is an example of it, it is difficult to go into the detail of those negotiations. You know, there is detail in all the discussions taking place. I think the general answer I would give you is we are not really at that stage. There has only been one meeting of the JMCEN. The second meeting, I think the fortnight reference was that the second meeting will take place within the next fortnight. We are planning to meet on a monthly basis, but the ability, you know, to do a great deal of detailed work in that time is limited. We are moving towards that, but we're not at that stage as yet.
So then there's not written detail that you could share with the committee at this stage?
I have spent a very long time saying exactly that. There is not written detail which I could presently share.
Jackie Bailey.
Just quickly, because we're all aware that the First Minister is in Dublin. John Bruton, the former Prime Minister of Ireland and indeed EU Ambassador to the US, said in relation to Scotland seeking a special deal, or call it whatever you will, about remaining in the EU single market, and I quote, "I think it is technically, administratively and politically impossible." Is he wrong? And what option do you believe offers the best alternative to deliver on the Scottish Government's ambitions?
Well, I think the difficulty with John Bruton's point and the difficulty with other points in this is that he is dealing with a past view of what the EU does and how it operates, not with the present realities. There has never been withdrawal from the EU, with the exception of Greenland, which is a very different set of circumstances. In all those circumstances, nothing is off the table, and that is absolutely clear, because the table hasn't been set as yet. The UK has not defined its negotiating position. It will only do so to a greater or lesser extent in the Article 50 letter, which maybe is likely to be at the end of March, so we're not entirely sure still. So I would say that John Bruton is probably correct in a retrospective look, but not correct in a prospective look, because the type of Europe we are entering into, the way in which it's organised, the way in which relationships take place, is entirely new and different. And there's another agenda going on, which is important for us to understand. Brexit is not the only thing that's happening within the European Union. There are many other things happening in terms of the shape and dynamics of the European Union. And therefore, I think we cannot, with any confidence or certainty, say what is possible or isn't possible. I said in response to Mr. Leonard, and I think it's a point that needs to be made, there are a lot of big difficulties ahead. Nothing we are talking about here is simple or easy. But I don't think we should use the term impossible in these circumstances, just as we shouldn't use the term red line or non-negotiable, because I think everything is, in a sense, up for grabs.
I don't think it's so much about the UK setting the table. I think the reality is that Europe will set the table for us. And the difficulty we have is the term impossible is not terms that we're using, it's terms that they are using. And he is not alone amongst a number of the EU members. So I'm curious as to, you can't be drawn on your negotiating position, I understand that. But I think there is a danger as we focus on our view and the UK view that we're forgetting the European view.
I very much agree. I have the great respect for Jackie Bailey. I used to sit in the committee with her. I think she's raising a very important issue in terms of what the European view is. And the European view is hard line and is getting harder line, and that's an attitude towards the UK. They are increasingly fed up with not understanding what's going on and hearing things which, in the words of the Dutch foreign minister about Boris Johnson, are intellectually incoherent. And there's no doubt that that's true. But we have to remember the four pillars that Michel Barnier has set himself for the negotiations, the last of which is the exceptionalisms. It is the Northern Ireland's, it is the Gibraltar's, which he has named. So they will require, and it is acknowledged that they will require to be special circumstances established or arrangements made. That is not only acknowledged by the UK government in terms of how it's talking about Northern Ireland, but it is also acknowledged by the Commission and the Council in the terms of Barnier's four pillars. So there is the opportunity to continue to debate and discuss this, and I genuinely do not believe that anything is unlikely or impossible, because the European Union has always been flexible, but in these circumstances, there are extraordinary circumstances, and we have to continue to talk about them.
I'll perhaps allow Dean Lockhart to come back in with one last point on this before we move to another.
Thank you. Just a very brief question for Mr. Russell. The Welsh First Minister has also said that he can't see how there can be separate market access arrangements to the UK between different nations within the UK, and that if Scotland had separate market access arrangements to the EU, there would have to be custom borders between Scotland and the rest of the UK. In that scenario, and I very much appreciate there are a number of different scenarios that may play out, where you had the choice between the UK single market or membership of the EU single market, which one would you prioritise, Mr. Russell? And I appreciate you would probably want the best of both worlds, but if there was a scenario where you had to choose between being retaining EU membership or having full access to the single market in the UK, which one would you prioritise?
Well, you will imagine I'm not going to be drawn on that situation, because I don't believe that's a real choice. But can I say I was with Carwyn Jones on Friday morning? I discussed this issue with him on Friday morning. In every sense, Carwyn Jones understands, as Mark Drakeford, his minister who's undertaking these negotiations, understands the complexities, the difficulties, the requirement to have a flexible approach, and the ability to say that nothing in this is going to be easy, but everything remains on the table. That was his position on Friday morning. It will remain his position now. And actually, we're working very closely with the Welsh government, with the Northern Irish, with the Irish, and with the UK, to find a way through these issues. And one of the important things is not to be drawn on false choices, but to try and make real choices.
Since this is the Economy Committee, can I just ask...
Mr. Lockhart, yes. I think the Minister cannot probably speak for the Welsh administration any more than for the UK administration. So I'd like to move on to another area at this stage, and Ash Denham has a question.
Thank you. I'd like to turn to possible effects that we're already seeing on the Scottish economy as a result of the EU referendum in June. So obviously we've seen a sharp drop in sterling, and that has the impact of rising costs for Scottish households. And I'm wondering, has the Scottish Government done any modelling so far, looking at the impact of, you know, for instance, rising energy costs, rising food costs on Scottish households?
I think you're right to say this has occurred to us. I think there was an estimate of potentially a 5% increase in prices for next year, and the impact that may have on interest rates, on disposable income, inflation first of all, and then interest rates after that. I'll ask the Chief Economist to talk about any particular modelling, but yes, we're very aware of that, and I've given the example previously in the Chamber of just one example, but a company in Ayrshire, which I visited recently, who produce double glazing and patio doors and so on, who said that actually at that point they hadn't seen a huge impact from the Brexit vote, bearing in mind we don't have Brexit yet, but they had just been told by their Irish glass suppliers to be a 15% increase in their costs. Now, that's one example, but we've seen that across a number of different sectors about cost. On the other side, of course, there are some beneficiaries in the meantime, especially those who benefit from the exchange rate having changed in the way that it has. But I don't know if the Chief Economist wants to talk about the modelling that's been undertaken.
Yeah, OK, thank you very much. So in a sense, in terms of the modelling impacts, we expect to see, as illustrated in the budget statement last week, a rise in inflation in the UK over the next year or two, which will obviously impact on household consumption, household affordability. We know from the data the key components of household expenditure budgets by different income groups, and we regularly look at that in terms of the impacts in sectors. It's probably worth just saying a little bit about the context of the depreciation, if I may, convener, in the context that the markets have took a view that the UK competitiveness will be impacted by that extent. So sterling, the movements in sterling reflected the view that the UK competitiveness will be impacted by the EU exit. The depreciation in itself is an adjustment mechanism to a shock, but we haven't had the Brexit shock yet. So what that mechanism is dealing with essentially is the uncertainty at the moment. And the price effects will take some time to come through. And what we're getting on the upside at the moment is the potential benefits around for certain exporters, also for inward investment and stuff. But the impacts will feed through to households, it will feed through to earnings, and ultimately to consumption. But the uncertainty around prices really has a big impact on future investment.
So I suppose that families that are, let's say, at the lower income levels, if they're spending more money on, you know, things that they can't avoid, like food and energy prices going up, they're going to have less disposable income to spend in other parts of the economy as well. So you'd see a wider impact there.
It's similar to the argument for a real living wage. If you increase people's income, people on very low incomes, to at least that level, then you've got more disposable income in the economy and more is spent. But you're absolutely right. And the Resolution Foundation estimate that low-income working families will be £2,200 a year worse off as a result of Brexit and the cuts by 2020. I mean, that's a huge amount for people on low incomes. And you're right to say as well that of necessity, they will end up having to pay first and foremost for necessities rather than any discretionary disposable income being used for other purposes.
Thank you.
Mr. Gillespie, you wanted to come back in on that.
Yeah, just to say we track household consumer confidence. We have a survey of 2,000 households, which we run each quarter. We started it in Q2 2013, and actually when we ran it in Q3 2016, it was the first time it had gone negative. And that was essentially households reflecting a view that the outlook was more uncertain in the future for their finances and the wider economy. So that type of uncertainty, if it translates into lower household expenditure, particularly on bigger ticket items, can have a substantial impact on the economy.
Could I
perhaps certainly. Simply say, convener, that there is a survey from last week, which I'm happy to provide to the committee, about positivity and negativity over the short, the medium and long term from people in Scotland and the rest of the UK. It shows a very considerable worsening in expectation since July, and Scotland is the most negative of all. There's almost been a doubling of pessimistic view, particularly for the longer term. The view for the medium term is declining, but for the longer term is pretty dramatic. I'm happy to make sure we provide that information so that members have seen it.
Ask if the survey was conducted on a Monday.
That I don't know, but most people don't like Mondays. I'm not going to break into song, but I think that is the case.
I just add one point, if I can. I think the survey also looked at people's expectations for where they would be in 10 years' time. Yes, so it was quite different from the more short-term one. So it was actually getting a sense of people's expectations going forward. And essentially, it's in the public domain, so we can provide it. Yeah.
Yep.
John Mason wanted to ask a follow-up question on the impact.
Yeah, it was on this kind of subject of import costs and so on and so forth. I mean, has the government looked at particular sectors which are going to be more perhaps adversely affected by the lower pound? I mean, I think engineering is a particular one that we had along at committee that expressed a bit of concern, presumably because they're importing quite a lot.
Yes, we have done. Just to finish on the last point, it's also true to say that Treasury has estimated a 12% fall in the price of sterling would increase the cost of a typical food and drink shop for a household of two adults and two children by around £120 a year, and also a £100 increase in clothing and footwear, just to go back to the point about necessities. On the sectors, it's true to say that we believe that all sectors will suffer as a result of this. The sterling depreciation provides, of course, for some companies both an opportunity and a threat, but for some sectors with low variable input costs, the depreciation offers that opportunity to sell more products and services to foreign markets. But for others, the depreciation will be mainly felt in the example I gave earlier in terms of increased input prices. And that, of course, squeezes margins and will affect profitability. But we do believe that the rise in input costs will affect all sectors. The extent will vary, and of course we have a dialogue with individual sectors, so whether it was Scotch whisky through the Scotch Whisky Association, engineering, you're absolutely right to say there's been particular concerns expressed there. I think the other one, which is really pronounced, would be in higher education, substantial concerns. And I think as well as all sectors, that means across both manufacturing and services that are provided, we expect it to affect every sector, but to a varying degree.
And although the pound has fallen already, obviously, so that's a historical fact, I mean, is it your feeling that with a lot of companies having hedged sterling or the currency, that we haven't really seen the impact yet? Because we were getting some indication from witnesses that it might be into 2017, even beyond, before that it really hits them, because then they really are going to have to pay the higher prices.
Well, I think you're right to say it wasn't an immediate impact for many companies in terms of the Brexit vote that took place. Certainly on the day that the vote took place, or the day after rather, I had a number of discussions with senior industry representatives, and actually quite a number said 6 months out is when they expected the first real effects to come through. But either William Hill or Gary Gillespie are probably best to answer the question how it will go in future. If I knew how it would go, then obviously that would be one up on everyone else. It's a very hard thing to predict. But as to what the economists say, perhaps Gary would want to add to that.
I mean, if I can say two points, just firstly, when in the Cabinet Secretary's open remarks, they mentioned that the economy through Q2 this year was still dealing with the aftershocks of 2015 oil and gas. And one of the things that we got quite a lot back from the company base that year was actually the high value of sterling was making it difficult, particularly for the manufacturing, engineering sectors who were selling into the European market. So that was a challenge, the high value of sterling. And we've seen it cited in a number of plant closures. So the reversal of that provides a bit of margin back to some of those businesses. But obviously contracts are set in different time periods, and the full impact of that won't come in until new contracts for supplies are negotiated. So there is that lag effect, as the Cabinet Secretary has alluded to. The other point worth mentioning is that in a single market, trade is very competitive, and actually the depreciation from a Scottish perspective may provide opportunities for import substitution. Now, that won't be appropriate for a lot of key sectors where it's international components or goods, but if you take food and drink and stuff, what you may see is supplier chains looking to domestic markets as a way to hedge against the sterling effect. So the depreciation, as I said earlier, in traditional economic terms, it's seen as a channel through which the economy can adjust to a shock. And in part of that is to make import costs more expensive and actually to look to a rebalancing within your economy. So I think the question around the future I won't answer to, but that's just some more context.
Yeah, I mean, if I could just respond to that, I mean, I think we're going to labour force next, but we actually had a witness last week who said that, in fact, if they couldn't bring in a labour force from Eastern Europe, then actually they would, rather than import substitution, it would be a increase in imports, because they just, if they couldn't grow fruit here, they would have to bring the fruit in from overseas. So I take the point Mr. Gillespie's made, but it's not just going to be the one way, is it?
For example, if you look at some farmed produce, a lot of the inputs to producing those goods comes from feed that's brought in externally, and of course that presents a different side of the equation. So it's not an absolutely, in fact, it's true of all the different sectors, and sometimes true for individual companies, that there are pluses and minuses in relation to this. I think, as I said in my opening statement, it's not unremittingly bad, but there seems to be a real and almost unique consensus amongst economists that this is going to have a very detrimental effect, and already is having a detrimental effect on the economy. But it's also true to say that we do have to, and individual companies, and I've said this whenever I've gone around the country, if they see opportunities for example, import substitution, we should encourage that to happen. And the enterprise and skills review that we're undertaking should be designed to make sure and maximise that. But on balance, we believe it to be Brexit to be an extraordinary act of self-harm to the economy, but that doesn't absolve us of the responsibility of trying to mitigate its effects and to grow the Scottish economy.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Julian Martin.
That leads very nicely onto my question, which is about the labour market itself. We've heard from a range of sectors who have got grave concerns about the pool of labour that they have had an opportunity to employ, which had been able to grow their businesses, grow the sector. You'll be familiar with some of them. I'm sure you're speaking to all the sectors. We had James Withers from Scottish Food and Drink, who gave one example, for example, in a very tight labour market area, which is just up in Aberlour, where Walker Shop Red was able to grow substantially because of the increased labour market that was there as a result of more migration coming from Eastern European countries. Now, Dean Lockhart has rightly pointed out that the Scottish Government has got certain levers in place to be able to increase our productivity. And so that's one question. How are we responding to the potential that we might have where we don't have access to that labour, not just the people who may stay here, but for the future? But also, what is our main ask of the UK government so that we still have access to that labour market, which will help us increase Scotland's productivity? So I suppose a question for the Cabinet Secretary on the one hand, and a question for the Minister on the other.
Might also want to respond in terms of post-study work visas in particular, but also the demands of the UK government. But you're absolutely right to say that there's a huge potential impact. If I think in my own area, some of the large major projects that we're undertaking just now rely extremely heavily on people from the rest of the EU working on those projects. And I think I've said at this committee before, part of my fear is that as we come towards the end of these projects, it tends to be a rundown, obviously, as you come to completing a project. People take a decision on where they think the next project should be. And in some cases, we have at least anecdotal evidence that they're saying, well, we're not sure about the future status of the UK in terms of the EU, so making a decision to go elsewhere. Even more pronounced, I think you've hinted in terms of the agricultural sector,
sector, we were very heavily reliant on EU nationals. I did see one figure, I think it was maybe mentioned in the Chamber, and this was London, and I appreciate the difference, where there was a hotel in London that had something like 200 of its 208 staff were actually EU or non-UK nationals. So it does show that in some of those sectors, we're extremely reliant upon individuals from out with the UK, and it's a vital part of our productivity. We've had an increase in our productivity, not nearly as much as I'd like to see, around 5% since 2007. But we have had an increase, and that's coincided with having a more open economy in terms of attracting people from across of the rest of the UK. It's probably true also to say in relation to dentistry and other sectors as well. So we have real challenges. It's been a central feature of our representations since the EU referendum, but perhaps in terms of the particular asks of the UK government, Mike Russell's more able to answer that.
Yeah, it has and remains a major topic for discussion. And if you look at the right across the economy this afternoon, we'll be debating tourism and the effect on the tourism sector. But the tech sector and the digital sector, particularly in Edinburgh, is very strongly affected, where there's a big interchange, particularly of younger people. The financial sector, about 20% of their workforce comes from other parts of the EU. In the health service, 9% of doctors. And the one that stops you short, essentially, is in the food and drink sector. 60% of the staff who work in abattoirs come from the rest of the EU. This may mean compulsory vegetarianism, unless we get it right. So there is a huge impact, and it's right across the board. That's a really extraordinary thing. Most people tend to think of this in one sector. And the evidence you had from berry growing and fruit picking is very dramatic, because there is a potential for people to say, if we can't get the labour, then we'll take the bushes elsewhere. We'll do things elsewhere. And that is very worrying. I have to say that the issue of migration seems to feature very large in the views of the UK government and to be a key driver in terms of the Brexit process. And of course, you cannot be within the single market either as a member of the EU or as a member of the EEA unless you accept free movement. If you will not accept free movement, and I see no indication that the UK government wishes to accept that, then you will not be in either of those economic arrangements. We will continue to press very strongly the need for involvement in the single market. The Welsh use the term full and unfettered involvement in the single market. There's many terms you can use, built upon the need for the Scottish economy to have workers coming here at various levels in almost every sector from other parts of the EU. Without that, Scotland would be very severely impacted indeed. That will be a key part of the discussions, and is a key part of the discussions, but the present indications from the UK government are not promising.
I'd like to pick up on some of what the Cabinet Secretary said with regard to the skills gap. So this situation has probably exposed some of the skills gaps that we have in Scotland. What are we doing to address those with the powers that we have at the moment?
We have the work that's been done on the new labour market strategy, which has been produced by my colleague Jamie Hepburn. And within that, we also have the related piece of work that we're doing on the enterprise and skills agencies. So that really is about identifying and seeing how we can quickly scale up on the areas that we understand to be challenges for us just now. The obvious ones to mention, from very particular positions, which have been an issue for some time, like HGV drivers has been an issue across the UK, not just in Scotland, but also in terms of digital skills as well as an issue that we have too. So, and also if you look at where we've seen the preponderance of people coming from elsewhere to work here, so some of the construction trades, we realise we have particular challenges in there. So the work that's been done to date is the production of the new labour market strategy, and that's been further bolstered by the review that we're taking on the enterprise and skills networks. So in relation to that, the four different agencies, Scottish Enterprise, High, also the Funding Council and Skills Development Scotland. The interaction between Skills Development Scotland on the one hand, the Funding Council, and that obviously includes colleges and local authorities. I think the work that's been done is trying to identify how we can make that more effective. But in terms of trying to boost particular sectors, that is laid out in the labour market strategy produced by Jamie Hepburn.
Is it fair to say that in some parts of Scotland where there is a very tight labour market, we're still going to have an issue? For example, Pickett Fish Processing, and myself and Liam Kerr went to see Denham's the other week, and they've got 95% of their workforce are from Eastern Europe.
I wonder if I might not just agree with that, but indicate the problem that exists in substitution. If there is a view that, for whatever reasons, and it's difficult to fathom, but for whatever the reasons, that positive input of labour should not be allowed to continue, the question is how you substitute it. Now, there simply aren't enough people in Scotland to do that, and although there are undoubtedly skills gaps, and I won't interfere in that area of policy, but I, as Education Secretary, for 5 years, I was very aware of that. Are there other places where you will find those workers, and they will come here? If you look at the experience that the Prime Minister had in India just a few weeks ago, it is absolutely obvious that the Indian government continues to press for greater migration into this country, particularly on the skilled sector. A lot of very skilled young graduates. And this was refused. Essentially, the failure of the Prime Minister's visit to India was built around that. There was no give. She described the present migration system as highly satisfactory. That in all those circumstances, there is no substitution. And therefore, there will be, if these workers are not here, and cannot come here because it's not static, there's an absolute need to guarantee the rights and residence of 191,000 who are here, but that's not a static situation. People come and go. And if it becomes that much harder to come here, then it simply won't happen. And I have heard it argued that what will happen is that there will be a different migration system which will be sectorally based. Many of us as MSPs have experience of dealing with the UK Borders Agency and with the Home Office on issues of migration. If you were to have a sectorally based system that was, for example, in a area of work that's dependent on seasonal, for example, in berry picking, the berries would have rotted on the bush by the time that had actually come into effect. So there's a very serious problem that is emerging for the economy, and there are no answers to it as yet.
Thank you very much.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. Now, I'm not suggesting I have all the answers, but a number of witnesses in front of this committee have suggested that we do have an opportunity now to reinvigorate our domestic workforce. We have youth unemployment in Scotland at 12%. There are some 70,000 young people in Scotland between the age of 16 and 24 not in employment, education or training. Andrew Fraser of Allender highlighted an increasing level of inactivity in the workforce by 54,000 this year. Would there not be policy measures in place where we could retrain and bring these people into the workplace to potentially replace limited free movement of nationals coming from the EU, if that indeed does transpire? Now, I'm not suggesting overnight we can make these 70,000 job ready, but surely we should start now and should have already have policies in place to bring these 70,000 people into the marketplace.
I'm no expert, and clearly that would be a matter for the Cabinet Secretary and for his team. But I have to say, I think it is highly, highly unlikely that you will substitute in the numbers or the skills required in order to do that in anything like a reasonable period of time. And given what we've seen today in terms of the indication that there's not to be any transition in case people thought they weren't leaving, then I think the problem being created, and it is being created for Scotland. Scotland did not vote for this. The problem being created is enormous and likely to be incredibly damaging if the present trajectory is followed.
Can I say I do substantially agree that we should be looking to reskill those people. I think it's worth, again, putting it in its correct context. If you have, as we have, I think 40,000 more people employed at above the pre-recession peak that we had before, and 166,000 more above the recession trough, as I mentioned in my opening statement, then if you're at a position of 4.7% across Scotland of unemployment, then you can imagine within that you have variations. So potentially substantially above that in some localities and well below that in other localities. And that may be, to some extent, coincident with some of the areas that Gillian Martin raised as well. So you could have unemployment potentially between 1% and 2% in some of these areas. And the question is where you draw in that additional labour. That doesn't mean to say, of course, that we shouldn't try to make sure, as we're trying to do through the labour market strategy and the skills review, that we have a better fit. And also we ensure that industry is much more involved in how we actually deliver the skills that are required in the future. But as against that, just to say that the dampening of employment prospects, which has been, you know, cited by virtually every economic expert there is a bigger issue in terms of that. The effect on the economy of Brexit is going to be a substantial risk. Doesn't mean to say that we shouldn't do as you've suggested and make sure that we have people ready for the jobs market. There's no question that we have to do more in relation to that, but I think the bigger issue really is the general impact on the economy. I don't know whether Convener Gary Gillespie wants to come in on that point.
Yeah, I mean, sorry, just to add a couple of thoughts to the comments. So in a sense, I think going back to the previous one, the labour market is really dynamic. We have flows in and out, both in terms of people moving from employment to inactivity. Not all inactivity is necessarily bad. Some of it is to do with further higher education or for family or personal reasons, looking after family or children. So there's dynamic flows all the time, people entering, people leaving, and also the dynamic with our UK and EU migrants. So in a sense, as the economy devolves, skills demands change over time as well. In the context of the youth unemployment and the rate of unemployment at the moment, it's interesting just to reflect. Pre-recession, we had pre-financial crisis, we had a record low in unemployment, which I think was around 4.6%. And at that time, our youth unemployment rate was 12%. And that higher rate reflected the kind of structural issues around new entrants to the labour market of their particular age, circumstances, and that transition path. Now, there's a lot of work being done to make that a smoother transition for that group, following a series of reviews. But the key thing, I think, in the labour market and the point around how you reduce the structural rate of unemployment gets back to the economic strategy and the focus on competitiveness and reducing inequality and reaching out to those furthest from the labour market. Because in a sense, that's how you bring those people into employment and that's how you boost the long-term capacity of the economy. We're having more people engaged. I think the point being made was, can you have direct substitution in a kind of dynamic market? Probably not, and probably for the reasons of location, skill specific, and this is an ongoing process. But the key point is the labour market is dynamic, and it's only 2 or 3 years ago where we were facing different skill shortages, oil and gas, engineering. So these skill shortages evolve all the time, and Skills Development Scotland track them, speak to employers, and shift the resources to meet those demands.
A degree of consensus here. Some witnesses have suggested even further flexibility in the labour market to encourage what they have referred to as internal migration to deal with the different regional patterns of economic supply and demand. So perhaps that's an area that the government could look further into in terms of the patterns of internal migration, if there is indeed to be a limit to EU nationals coming into Scotland.
Right, I'll move on to Andy Whiteman now, has a question.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome, Minister, Cabinet Secretary. My question is about inward investment. We heard evidence from the Chief Economist of RBS, Stephen Boyle, who said that if we have a fixed pot of money for the purposes of promoting internationalisation, that money will likely be more productively spent on export promotion than on the attraction of foreign direct investment. And yet, Professor Jeremy Peat also said that a lot of the high productivity, high skill, export-oriented businesses are based on inward investment as much as domestic investment. What work is the government undertaking to adapt its strategy around inward investment to reflect both the uncertainty but also the possibilities of improving exports by indeed increasing inward investment?
Well, I think to the two witnesses you've cited, I would My answer would be that both of those things are important. Inward investment often can also bring with it new skills and new productivity gains into the market as well, into the domestic economy, which I think is extremely important. And, you know, we can't get complacent about the fact it often brings well-paying jobs with it, which are vitally important to people. So I think we want to continue to do that. And in addition to what we are currently doing, we recognise that there's an interdependence and there are complementary assets that are shared between, for example, Scotland and London in key sectors such as financial services and technology. So London, as I mentioned in response to a previous question, is very important to us. The vast majority of inward investment in the UK comes into London. It often then goes out of the UK altogether for the actual investment, but we also do tap in to a substantial degree. What we are trying to do is to try and present a more effective, if you like, Team Scotland approach. So we've worked with the seven cities who have their own pitch book of investments. These are ones driven by the cities themselves for what they'd want to see being invested in. And of course, I've mentioned already the doubling of the number of SDI staff across the EU. We've seen, for example, the number of offices that we have in India grow from 1 to 3. And I think we recognise in terms of India and China that we're starting from a very low base, but we are building up those relationships. It tends to be the case, certainly in China and in my limited experience in the Middle East, that these things do depend upon building up relationships over a period of time. So in terms of exporting, we are, if you like, increasing our activity but also trying to increase its focus so that we don't have people representing Scotland or parts of Scotland's pitch for investment, if you like, tripping over each other. We do it in a more coordinated way. And similar in relation to inward investment, we don't intend to take a backward step from the position that's seen us achieve, I think, 2 years in the last three, the second highest per capita investment from elsewhere in the UK, second only after, I think, the South East and London, and then just London. So that's been extremely successful, and that's according to the Ernst & Young studies. So I think we're trying to see how, and we recognise, as has been mentioned a number of times, the challenging nature of the economic environment we're going into. And in that context, increasing our inward investment is going to be extremely important, as is exporting more of what we produce. So I think there's efforts in both those areas.
Just to follow up on the inward investment aspect of that, though, to what extent are you aware of companies or investors interested in investing in Scotland who are whose investment is conditional on the membership of the single market, and to what extent is that an issue you're having to deal with?
I think it's, to be honest, it's very hard to say, because somebody that sat and made a decision not to invest in Scotland or the UK because of what they perceive to be uncertainty about the membership of the single market are not necessarily people that will tell you about that. Anecdotally, and it'd be interesting to see the experience of others, I went to one company on the outskirts of Edinburgh recently who themselves are involved in 33 different countries. This was actually 3 or 4 months ago, to be honest, but after the vote. And they said they were aware of an investment decision which was going, instead of, to, in that case, Scarborough, going to Frankfurt instead because of the Brexit vote. Didn't say it was a huge investment, but they had seen that. So I think it's hard to quantify. It tends to be anecdotal evidence, and it's perhaps not fair to offer that up as a position. But it will be in the nature of those decisions that you'll often not get to hear about what you've not managed to achieve, because companies will have just made the decision to go elsewhere. There are other anecdotal there's other anecdotal evidence I can give, but I don't know whether Gary has more system or Mike has got more system. For example, Mike, Russ and I met jointly with the major Japanese companies which are involved in Scotland, some very substantial companies, and some of which have a number of different divisions active in Scotland. Very large employers in many cases, very happy with being in Scotland, but expressing, I think it's fair to say, not a threat, but one or two saying that without the EU, without current arrangements, then they would put a big question mark over their continued involvement in Scotland.
This is not a static situation in that regard. There are people who, you know, the Hitachi report earlier this month showed that there was something like 6.5 billion of investment in the economy that was being withheld presently because of uncertainty. But there are also existing companies who will either hold back on that investment, some of that's within that figure, or who will begin to ask whether it does give them the access to the single market, for example, that they required when they were established. So the climate is changing and the possibilities are changing for those who are investing in that climate. It is worth reading the Japanese letter from the Japanese government on the issue of Brexit, which was issued in August, early September, which I think remains one of the key documents in this area, which looks at what is required for companies to continue to have confidence. And one of those, the two most important things are transition, which the UK government appears to be setting its face against, and transparency, so that people know what situation they're in. And I think whatever else you could say about the present situation, it's not very transparent.
If I may just add two very quick points on that subject. So in a sense, for companies looking at the UK or Scotland as a source of investment, there's two basic types. One, the first, essentially, the market access is key around the four freedoms, looking to come into the UK or Scotland to service that market. The other one that's probably more important is the ongoing investment, the stock of EU and UK and foreign-owned businesses that are in Scotland at the moment. And ongoing investment tends to go under the radar, and in a sense that's potentially more of a threat if companies are thinking around their future different scenarios about where they could operate. I think one of the earlier questions asked around the concentration of exports by a small number of sectors. Companies tend to be much more global now, much more integrated in their supply chains. We'll have opportunities and networks in different outlets. And that's the risk, I think, around potentially losing capacity down the line.
Just to say that in relation to that company I mentioned in the west of Edinburgh, I asked them about the impact of, at that time, the vote on Brexit had been about 2 months old, and they said, given the fact that they are active in 33 different countries around the world, the most difficult thing they had to deal with was trying to explain to their counterparts in those 33 countries why. They were asked, why did the UK vote for it? And they could not give, in their view, an export-driven international company an explanation as to why the UK had done that.
Thank you.
Jackie Bailey.
Very, very tiny question, but one of substance, I think. Scottish Government has its own economic strategy published some time ago, a trade and investment strategy published in early 2016. In light of Brexit, are you not reviewing them both to ensure that we are properly focused on what we need to do?
I think in terms of the economic strategy, it was interesting that in the course of the review into the enterprise and skills agencies that we had recently, which reported on phase one, there was a lot of potential for discussion around that. And a lot of the feedback, I think there was 300 plus responses, did not seek to question the current economic strategy that we have. They actually supported the economic strategy about inclusive and sustainable economic growth. You've mentioned that we have changed our trade strategy. I've mentioned a number of different elements of that, the four-point plan which the First Minister laid out, including increasing our representation, including the number of people that are involved in promoting that strategy, making sure there's a sharper focus amongst all ministers in terms of promoting that as well. So I think we have reflected the changed circumstances, given as well the kind of continuing uncertainty as to what the outcome of these discussions will be, as Mike Russell's laid out. Obviously, we have to keep our eye on that and adapt as we go along. But I think the changes we've made, you know, in terms of the growth scheme that we have being developed just now, in terms of the enterprise and skills review, in terms of beefing up the trade side of what we're doing just now, and in terms of investment, attracting our investment, I think we have responded to that situation. But no, we haven't changed the economic strategy.
I'm curious, Convener, just on a very small point, because Professor Graham Roy, in a former employment, had a direct hand in shaping that strategy, and it's his view that in light of the severity of posed by Brexit, that the strategy should be reviewed and should reflect that. So I wonder whether you'd take that away and consider that.
But certainly, I think, as I've said already, we all know that we're in a rapidly changing situation where the outcomes are uncertain, and you always want to have a view I'll be able to take a view on those. But I do think the changes which are made in terms of investment and trade perhaps reflect a different emphasis underneath that strategy. But of course, we always want to look at these things as circumstances develop.
Thank you. Richard Leonard.
Yeah, you mentioned in your opening remarks, Cabinet Secretary, about your last appearance here on the 28th of June. And you said on that occasion of the Manufacturing Action Plan that you would, and I've got it in the quotation marks here, I would like it to be extended further to turn it into the kind of industrial policy that used to be fashionable. There are certain things that I will be able to make public shortly that will demonstrate that we are taking a more holistic approach. I wonder if 5 months and a day on, you could elaborate on that.
Yes, I think to give one example of what was meant then, what has now become public that wasn't at that time, is the work that's been done largely by my colleague Fergus Ewing, for example, in relation to the Rio Tinto Alcan developments, which have now been announced, the safeguarding of, I think from memory, 150 jobs, but with the potential for many more. Now, I mention that because that shows the links that there are between the work that's being done there and proposed to be done there with other parts of industry which can support industry. For example, it may be the case with the move from steel to aluminium and cars, that what you'll see, instead of steel being moved around different places between car production plants and steel production plants, you may be able to have a domestic source for the raw materials for car production. So I do know that much of the work in relation to that, and it's also true in a number of other areas that we're looking at just now, you are seeing people thinking about the whole industrial strategy, you know, not just one production facility, but how you can actually produce the raw materials for that as well. So that's the kind of thing I had in mind in relation to that. And of course, we have produced a strategy, and we're looking to establish the Manufacturing Centre of Excellence. There are other areas which, if we're successful in actually achieving that, you'll see the linkage that I mentioned. I think what's interesting since last time we discussed it is the UK government are now saying something very similar. We've not seen, I think, a huge degree of evidence, but certainly in the discussions I've had with UK ministers, they are talking about, I think Liam Fox was the last one, I think, the UK government wanting to develop an industrial strategy. And just to come back to a previous point made by Dean Lockhart in relation to that, we may have some of these tools, but exports are mentioned. Export guarantees for overseas companies are provided by the UK government. It's a mixed picture in relation to that. And what I am keen to do, genuinely, with the UK government that made this offer, is if we can work together in relation to this. I mean, I could just mention some of the sectors where there's some of the discussions ongoing, shipbuilding being one of them, that we can actually start to see, instead of one plant producing something, you can see a whole supply chain moving into a customer base which is sustainable in the longer term. So these are some of the things we're trying to do in order to make sure we have a coherent industrial strategy.
Do you plan to publish a paper?
Well, of course, we can do that. I think what we're doing just now is working on the immediate challenges which we face, but I think that will be related to the establishment of the Manufacturing Centre of Excellence in due course.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned Dean Lockhart, so I'll let him come back in with a very minor point, I think, just as we draw to a close here.
Thank you, Convener. It's in response to a parliamentary response Mr. Swinney made last week when he announced that the individual boards of the enterprise agencies and the other agencies would be replaced by the Board of Trade. Cabinet Secretary, can you tell me or tell us when this will take place, and how will you ensure that the Board of Trade will have an understanding of the very different remits carried on by those individual agencies?
Yeah, I think perhaps there's some confusion about the Board of Trade and the Strategic Board, which is to be established as a result of the Enterprise and Skills Review, if I'm reading the member's question correctly. So the Board of Trade is quite separate from that, which is, as I say, we've agreed or in the process of agreeing the membership of that just now. The Strategic Board, which would be the replacement for the boards that the member mentions. Well, first of all, to say that the Enterprise and Skills Review, you're asking about the timescale when this will happen. So the phase two of that will take us through until March next year. That's the current estimate for that. And one of the first tasks it met last week that it's been given is to look at the governance arrangements for the different agencies. So just to be very clear that Highlands and Islands Enterprise will remain as an agency, a statutory agency, as will the other agencies. The question of their governance, the question to which they relate to their local areas, and how they relate to the strategic board, which I think is necessary for the hard alignment I mentioned before, is one that's being discussed by them currently. So that, as I say, if it's a timescale that's been looked at, we expect that to come back over the course of the next 6 months. It's not the case we have to wait until that's done. Some things can be announced during that process, but that's the kind of timescale we're working towards.
Thank you. And Andy Whiteman has indicated he has a very, very small point to make on this, and this will be the last question today. Andy Whiteman.
Cabinet Secretary, thank you. I wonder if, to help clarify this, you might indicate whether it's your view that Helens and Islands Enterprise, after this review is completed and after the changes have been implemented, will continue to have its own legal personality?
The agency will remain, and it will remain in law. It's established, I think, by primary legislation, but it's established in law, so that's not intended to change.
Right. Thank you very much to the Cabinet Secretary, the Minister and the officials for attending today. We'll move on into private session now. Thank you very much. Yes.